Rob's house. He suggests in this book, as I mentioned in my review, well, Trotsky really didn't develop the theory of the permanent revolution. That was the property of Alexander Helfand, known as Paulus. You know, if you read Trotsky's My Life, whatever comment he makes on the theory of the permanent revolution, he says, well, of course, Helfand contributed the lion's share of the theory of the permanent revolution, in the sense that he agreed with Trotsky that in Russia, the capitalist democratic revolution, that is land reform, unification of the country, the overthrow of the thousand year Tsarist regime, that capitalist democratic revolution could not be carried through by the so-called liberal capitalists. Because the industrial capitalists were tied to the land in the modern era, the land is tied to industry, and for instance, if you take a country like India, the completion of the capitalist democratic revolution, of a thorough land reform, is not complete in India at the present time. But to carry through a massive agrarian revolution comes up against the opposition, not just of the landlords, but of the capitalists. And therefore, Trotsky said, they would not complete this revolution. Who could carry it through then? That would have to be carried through by the working class, and Helfand agreed with this, but then Helfand stopped short and said, well, the kind of regime in an alliance with the peasantry that would come out of this would be something like the Labour governments in Australia, where the first Labour government in history came to power at the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century. But these governments were within the framework of capitalism. They didn't challenge capitalism. And Trotsky went further than Helfand and said, no, if the working class comes to power, it will complete the capitalist democratic revolution. But having come to power, it couldn't stop there. It would then go over to the socialist task. Not only in Russia, because in isolation, Russia wasn't ready for socialism. All trends of opinion in Russia at that stage agreed. But from a world point of view, capitalism was rotten ripe for overthrow. And therefore, the Russian Revolution would be the spark that would ignite the world revolution itself. And how marvellously that was actually confirmed by the march of events itself. Lenin was indisputable as the leader with Trotsky of the Russian Revolution. Lenin came to the position of Trotsky. It wasn't the other way around. On the task of the revolution, Trotsky was more correct than Lenin, by the way. But Lenin, with that genius for improvising in the situation and seeing how the process developed, in effect, Lenin and Trotsky came to the same position in the run-up and in the course of the Russian Revolution. And in a private conversation with one of Trotsky's friends, Yoff, he admitted that Trotsky was right on the permanent revolution. Lenin was never a kind of vain individual who, when a mistake was made either by himself, by the young workers' state, or by anybody else, or when they were correct, he was very generous in admitting that a mistake had been made by him, that the other person was right, because truth, telling the truth in the workers' movement is not an option. You have to tell the truth, both about victories and defeats. If you have a defeat, if you have a setback, and you don't openly correct that setback, then you prepare for bigger mistakes and bigger faults in the future. That's why the socialist and the militant before was ruthless when we made a mistake. Like in Liverpool, didn't come up, I believe, in the session on Liverpool yesterday, on the redundancy notices, we told the truth. Not after the fact, but at the time. This was a mistake. And we, in the course of that, we tried to prepare our comrades for the situation of a similar position in the future, which would in effect be repeated if it wasn't corrected in that way. Now, as is known, the isolation of the Russian Revolution led to the rise of the bureaucracy. But let us not forget, in stating that fact, that before then, there was numerous opportunities for the working class to take power. In Hungary in 1919, buffered the mistake that was made by Belokon. The German workers battered at the foundations of capitalism in 1918 to 1923. And by the way, Servius, in his material on Germany, says, well, Trotsky took no interest in 1923. If you read the analysis of Trotsky, and we're going to write material, by the way, on 1923, because the German Revolution, in some ways, is more important for us, because it was in a highly industrialized country, than even the Russian Revolution. As marvelous as it was in a backward country. Germany approximates more, and the process of revolution and counter-revolution approximates more to the task that we face now in the advanced industrial countries itself. But Germany was on the verge of revolution in 1923. They could have taken power, the German workers, in a period of 3 months. As a matter of fact, the leader of the German Communist Party, Brandler, went to Moscow and had discussions about taking the power. And in one discussion, he said to Trotsky, "I've got no doubt we could take the power, and we could establish a Soviet Germany. The problem is what happens afterwards." And Trotsky said to Brandler, "You don't know what's going to happen afterwards. It could be civil war. The ruling class may not be able to resist, but you've got to take the power now." And Brandler felt his own inadequacies to such an extent that he actually suggested that Trotsky be sent secretly to Germany to organize the insurrection. That was vetoed by Stalin and by Zinoviev for personal ambition, for their own personal position. But this man is a professor. He's a learned professor in history. How can he make a mistake like that in examining the archives? But that's the kind of thing that they'd be able to get away with. No more. We're going to refute these gross distortions of the position of Trotsky in order to prepare the situation in the future. Now, another point that he makes, that Serres makes, is that Trotsky was no different to Stalin. And this is a vital point for us to understand. In other words, both of them presided over a bureaucratic regime. Now, let us concede, by the way. Lenin described the state of Russia, the worker state of Russia, from 1917 to 1923, which in my opinion was the most democratic state, especially in the early stages. The Soviets were somewhat emasculated during the Civil War and the isolation of the revolution. But with the revolution, the most revolutionary party in history, you have to say, in our opinion, this is the most democratic state in history. But Lenin and Trotsky didn't pull the wool over the workers' eyes. They said this was a workers' state, but with bureaucratic problems. Let's put it like that. Bureaucratic features. And what he meant by that is because of the isolation of the revolution, the destruction of the working class, you've had even bureaucratic features under their regime. But it was nothing compared to the Stalinist state. It's like a pimple on a body compared to an ulcer, a cancerous ulcer that eats away with the body and eventually results in, of course, the restoration of capitalism as we've seen it. His arguments in relation to Lenin and Trotsky was absolutely false, by the way. I haven't got time to deal with the application of the permanent revolution. Others will come in. But in the neo-colonial world, Trotsky was more correct on the question of Germany, for instance, not just in 23, but in the run-up to the triumph of Stalin of Hitler in 1933. The fact is that Trotsky was very careful in his analysis of Stalinism. When an old Trotskyist, as he was at that stage, C.L.R. James, wrote a book called The World Revolution in the late 1930s. He was a cricketing expert as well, by the way, C.L.R. James. Very English in that sense, combining revolution with cricket, not with golf, as is the case today. But in the course of this book, he makes the point, C.L.R. James makes the point, that Stalin wanted the defeat of the Chinese Revolution of 25-27. And he wanted the defeat of the Communist Party in Germany between 1930 and 1933. Now that is wrong. Trotsky corrected him on that. He didn't argue that Stalin or Radek or Zinoviev or Kamenev rather, that they wanted the conscious defeat of the revolution at that stage. The mistakes that arose, the loss of the opportunities that